Good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to Oncology Classroom. As you all know, this month we are discussing different topics on pediatric oncology. Today evening, we have a very interesting talk on pediatric gliomas, including brainstem glioma. And we are fortunate to have Dr. Ahidagni Bishwas with us, who is working as associate professor in the Department of Radiation Oncology at prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Dr. Bishwas is an alumnus of the same institute, and he has his keen interest on neuro-oncology and pediatric oncology both. And I think this is a perfect fit for him. Thank you, Dr. Bishwas, for accepting this invitation and being with us. May I now request you to please take over the session and start your presentation. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Dudun, for this kind introduction. So I'm trying to share my screen. So just let me know if I'm audible or not. Am I audible?
Yes, your voice is clear.
Okay. And is the screen visible properly?
Yeah.
And the laser pointer is also seen?
Yes.
Okay, fine. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The topic assigned to me tonight is management of pediatric glioma. So I would give a very brief outline of the talk. So I would be speaking on low-grade glioma and the role of surgery, chemotherapy, radiation therapy, untargeted therapy in such tumors. Subsequently, I will be moving to high-grade glioma and I will be talking about the role of surgery, radiation therapy, chemotherapy, and various experimental therapies. I will be next moving to brainstem glioma and talking about the various kind of brainstem gliomas, like the focal low-grade gliomas, the dorsal exophytic gliomas, the cervicomedullary gliomas, and the diffuse intrinsic pontine gliomas. I will not be speaking about the optic pathway gliomas and the spinal cord gliomas because of paucity of time. And this will be followed by summary and take-home message. So coming to the point, low-grade astrocytoma, basically WHO grades 1 and 2, so they are benign and they comprise a heterogeneous group of tumors. They follow an indolent clinical course with overall survival rates at 10 to 15 years, as much as 80 to 100%. So as per the anatomical location, the low-grade astrocytomas can be grouped into cerebellar astrocytomas, which constitute 15 to 20% of all CNS tumors. The hemispheric astrocytomas, which constitute 10 to 15% of all CNS tumors. The midline supratentorial tumors in the basal ganglia, thalamus, which constitutes 10 to 15% of all CNS tumors. The optic pathway tumors, which constitute 5% of all CNS tumors. Brainstem low-grade astrocytomas. Brainstem tumors in general constitute 10 to 15% of all CNS tumors, and 20 to 30% of these tumors are low-grade astrocytomas. Spinal cord low-grade astrocytomas, again, spinal cord tumors constitute roughly 5% of all CNS tumors, and majority of them, around 60%, are low-grade astrocytomas. So coming to a brief introduction of pediatric low-grade glioma and pathology of the same. So the most common prototype is the pilocytic astrocytoma. So they account for majority of low-grade glioma and commonly involve the cerebellum and the anterior optic pathway. They're extremely well-defined and are solid cystic in nature. And on histology, they show a biphasic pattern with a varying proportion of bipolar and multipolar cells. There is an abundance of Rosenfeld fibers and microcysts. So recently, BRAF fusions have been identified in the large majority of patients of pilocytic astrocytoma. Often we can encounter a variant of pilocytic astrocytoma, which is known as the pilomyxoid astrocytoma, which is more aggressive and may show leptomeningeal dissemination. So moving on to the diffuse astrocytoma, it constitutes 10 to 15% of all low-grade gliomas in pediatric age group. So most intrinsic pontine tumors and hemispheric tumors are diffuse astrocytomas. They're not very well circumscribed and they grow by infiltration rather than destruction of anatomic structures. Under the microscope, they show well-differentiated fibrillary or genistocytic neoplastic astrocytes And nuclear atypia is one of the hallmarks of diffuse astrocytoma, in addition to increased cellularity. The growth pattern, that is the MEIB1 leveling index, is usually low in diffuse astrocytomas compared to anaplastic astrocytomas. And diffuse astrocytomas, especially in adults, may undergo malignant transformation. However, the same phenomenon is not very common in the pediatric age group, with the exception of pontine tumors. So this is how the pilocytic astrocytoma and the diffuse fibrillary astrocytoma, they look under the microscope. Coming to the symptoms, they depend upon the site of the tumor. So symptoms and signs of raised intracranial tension are often discerned in midline and cerebellar tumors due to ventricular obstruction. Neck stiffness and torticollis may be seen in posterior fossa tumors. Seizures are common in hemispheric tumors. Focal motor deficits, again common in hemispheric tumors. Visual field cutoffs may be seen in optic pathway tumors, neuroendocrine deficits and endocrinopathies and hypothalamic tumors. And diencephalic syndrome may be seen in young children with chiasmatic hypothalamic tumors. So this is a rare syndrome where a child is usually emaciated with loss of subcutaneous fat in spite of a normal appetite. A child may look pale in spite of absence of anemia, and very hyperactive with increased vigor, and nystagmus is one of the key clinical features. So the pilocytic astrocytomas, they are usually very well circumscribed. They are solid cystic in nature, and often the cystic portion may be larger than the solid portion and can cause distressing symptoms. Associated edema and mass effect is minimal, and they show a brilliant homogeneous contrast enhancement of the solid portion on T1 post-CAT sequences. So this is how a left-sided thalamic pilocytic astrocytoma looks on T1 post-CAT image and flare image respectively. The diffuse or fibrillary astrocytomas are not very well defined, and on CT or MRI, they are not seen very well. They show little enhancement after administration of contrast, and the extent is best seen on T2 or flare images. For example, we can see a patient with bilateral diffuse astrocytoma of the ganglio-thalamic region. This is better seen on the flare sequence compared to the T1 plane sequence. So coming to the treatment option, so the first thing we are going to discuss is surveillance. Some low-grade gliomas may be detected on routine imaging, and despite mild or no symptom, they may remain stable over long periods of time. So basically, they have a long natural history, and surveillance may be the appropriate initial management in such cases. So this option is particularly valid for pectal plate lesions, where only a CSF diversion may be required, or patients with NF1, as many as 15% of whom have optic pathway tumors or other astrocytic or hamartomatous lesions, typically in the brainstem. So the common characteristics of these very indolent tumors are small size, less than 2 cm. They are usually hypodense or hypointense on CT or MRI respectively, and they are non-enhancing on contrast administration. So follow-up with MRI is important to identify patients with progressive disease, and on progression, surgery or radiotherapy may be considered, and it provides long-term disease control. So this is the treatment algorithm for patients with pediatric low-grade glioma, where surveillance is not a suitable option. So initially, maximal safe resection compatible with good neurological outcome should be considered. And subsequently, the patients are subjected to clinical follow-up with routine MR imaging. At the time of progressive disease, a second surgical resection may be considered. And on further progression, or if second surgery is not possible, chemotherapy may be considered for infants and younger children less than 10 years, and all patients with NF1. Radiation therapy may be considered for symptomatic progressive disease in older patients. Now, coming to surgery in pediatric low-grade glioma, the mainstay of treatment, and complete resection is more likely in small tumors which are well circumscribed and tumors in non-eloquent areas of the brain. So modern surgical techniques include computer-assisted resections, that is neuronavigation, and this is aided by preoperative functional MRI, MR tractography, intraoperative mapping of eloquent areas, intraoperative MRI, so on and so forth. Complete resection is now achieved in more than 80% of cerebral, cerebellar, and spinal cord tumors, and about 50% of deep midline tumors. So this is an image of functional MR images where we can identify the trajectory to be followed for excision of GNET in the right occipital lobe and sparing the optic radiation, the corticospinal tract, and occipital cortex. So children with low-grade glioma who undergo complete resection, they fare extremely well with long-term disease-free survival and overall survival rates of 80 to 100%. In most series, the results are better in patients with pilocytic astrocytoma. In either type, post-operative RT is not indicated after complete resection. However, for children who undergo less than complete resection, the PFS after surgery is less satisfactory. In a joint children's cancer group, pediatric oncology group study, it was demonstrated that there was an inferior PFS rate after subtotal excision. And this was more profound if the amount of residual tumor was more than 1.5 cubic centimeter. However, the majority of patients could be salvaged using a second surgical resection and or RT, and the 8-year overall survival rates were in excess of 90%. Now coming to chemotherapy in pediatric low-grade glioma. So when adjuvant therapy is indicated, options include chemotherapy, particularly for infants and young children less than 10 years and for patients of all ages with NF1. Because these patients are at greatest risk of neurocognitive, neuroendocrine, and more importantly, vaso-occlusive complications of treatment. So patients with NF1 after radiation therapy can develop the Moya-Moya syndrome, which is basically thromboembolic vaso-occlusive complication of the circle of Willis. And this can lead to cerebrovascular accident in the worst case scenario. And radiation therapy should be strongly avoided in such patients. The standard combination chemotherapy is a doublet of carboplatin and vincristine. Complete response to chemotherapy is kind of elusive. However, disease control rate, which is in other words CR plus PR plus stable disease, is to the tune of 70 to 100%. And it has been seen that use of chemotherapy can permit delay of radiation therapy by 2 to 4 years or even longer than that. So this is a tabular representation of the various chemotherapy regimens used in pediatric low-grade glioma. So we can see that mostly platinum drugs, as platinum or carboplatin, vincalcaloids, vincristine or vinblastine, alkylating agents like cyclophosphamide, and sometimes epipodophyllotoxins like etoposide. So these are the active individual agents. And the combination of such agents usually leads to a 3-year progression-free survival ranging from 50 to 80% in different studies. So the most popular combinations are a doublet of carboplatin and vincristine, or the TPCV regimen, which is basically thioguanin plus the PCV regimen, procarbazine, CCNU, and vincristine. So I would like to take you through a couple of studies which in my mind are important pertaining to chemotherapy in low-grade glioma. So this is a European randomized controlled trial of addition of etoposide to standard vincristine and carboplatin as a part of 18-month treatment program for childhood low-grade glioma. So this was published in European Journal of Cancer in 2017. This randomized controlled trial was conducted by the SIOC Low-Grade Glioma Committee, and 497 newly diagnosed patients were randomized to VC or the VCE regimen. The VC regimen basically consists of injection vincristine, which is given weekly at the rate of 1.5 milligram per meter square, and carboplatin is 550 milligram per meter square IV every 3 weeks, and the duration of this chemotherapy regimen is 18 months. And the VCE regimen is basically the same regimen with additional etoposide, 100 milligram per meter square IV day 1 to day 3, given in the first 4 cycles in the induction phase, that is weeks 1, 4, 7, and 10. So let us focus on the clinical outcome. There was no significant difference in response rate and non-progression at 6 months in the two regimens. And the 5-year progression-free survival and the overall survival rates were pretty similar. The adverse prognostic factors which impacted PFS and OS were age less than 1 year and presence of Diencephalic syndrome. So the authors concluded the addition of etoposide to VC did not improve PFS or OS, and VC remains the standard first-line therapy in pediatric low-grade gliomas. So the next trial I'd like to discuss is the non-randomized comparison of NF1 and non-NF1 type children received carboplatin and vincristine for progressive low-grade glioma, a report from the COG. So this was basically the COGA9952 protocol. The non-NF1 patients were randomized to VC or TPCV, as I discussed previously. The NF1 patients were only assigned to VC. 42 NF1 patients, basically one-third of all the NF1 patients at events, and around 5% of them died. Pertaining to treatment-related acute toxicities, they were less profound in patients with NF1. Now, focusing on the clinical outcome, the response rate was 46% versus 35% in favor of patients with NF1. And the five-year EFS was 69% versus 39%, again in patients with NF1. The five-year overall survival was 98% versus 87%, again in patients with NF1. On multivariate analysis, NF1 independently was associated with better EFS, but not with OS. And it is notable that three patients with NF1 developed second malignant neoplasms, all before receiving radiation therapy. So the authors concluded that children with NF1 tolerated VC better and had superior response rate and event-free survival compared to children without NF1 in this study. Now moving to radiotherapy in pediatric low-grade glioma. So largely due to improvements in surgery and to a lesser extent due to successful treatment of younger children with systemic chemotherapy, there has been a substantial decrease in the use of RT over recent years. Currently in North America and Europe, hardly 10% of all children with low-grade astrocytomas receive radiation therapy. So what are the strong or clear-cut indications of radiation therapy? So incomplete resection in situations where tumor progression otherwise may potentially compromise neurological function. For example, threat to vision, basically like a tumor which has been incompletely resected and is juxtaposed, say, to the optic chiasma. If the tumor progresses, there might be compromise of the vision. So in such scenario, radiation therapy may be considered. And also radiation therapy should be considered for progressive symptomatic disease in older children, more than 10 years. So the GTV is the disease seen on MRI performed just prior to treatment. So there has been a kind of tectonic shift. Previously we used to focus on the preoperative Gross disease. Now we need to focus only on the postoperative Gross disease in low-grade gliomas. The CTV consists of the GTV as seen on T1 post-CAD images in pilocytic astrocytoma with a margin of 0 to 1 centimeter only. In diffuse astrocytoma, the GTV has to be delineated on T2 or FLIR images, and the CTV basically consists of the same with an anatomically constrained expansion of 1 to 1.5 centimeter. The RT planning should take into account various organs at risk, including the temporal lobe and the hippocampus, and future protocols will specify specific dose constraints for the same. So this is a pictorial depiction. These are basically the MR images, T1 post-CAT MR images of a patient with pilocytic astrocytoma of the left cerebellar peduncle at the age 8. These are the preoperative images. After surgery, a small volume of disease is left behind and this gradually grows, and patient is considered for radiation therapy. So we need to focus not on the preoperative disease volume, but we need to focus on the current disease volume at the time of RT. So coming to radiotherapy dose, so there is scant evidence for a dose-response correlation in pediatric low-grade astrocytomas. There have been European and North American studies that randomized adult patients with low-grade astrocytomas with low dose, that is 45 to 50.4 gray, and high dose, that is 59.4 to 64.8 gray. And the high dose failed to demonstrate any advantage pertaining to clinical outcome. Now, it's important that we understand there are biological differences in low-grade astrocytomas in children and adults. And children who have progressed on chemotherapy may have tumors that are less sensitive to radiation therapy. Hence, it is unwise to extrapolate that in children lower doses of 45 to 50 gray are as effective as the current standard of 54 to 55 gray in low-grade astrocytomas. However, in tumors which are closely juxtaposed to various critical organs at risk, like the optic chiasma or brainstem, a dose of 50.4 gray may be considered on a case-to-case basis. External beam RT using conventional dose fractionation schedule of 1.8 gray per fraction per day should be considered the standard of care. And the RT technique should provide homogeneous and conformal irradiation of the target volume with simultaneous sparing of the critical organs at risk. The technique of radiotherapy has evolved from 3D conformal RT to IMRT VMAT, and there is a preference, strong preference for stereotactic radiotherapy and proton beam therapy if available. SRS or fractionative stereotactic radiosurgery using the gamma knife or linear accelerator based techniques may be used to deliver a single dose of 10 to 20 gray or a few large fractions to the periphery of the lesion, especially in small pilocytic astrocytomas. Interstitial brachytherapy using iodine-125 seeds also has been practiced in select European centers. And for cystic low-grade astrocytomas, especially in patients with recurrent disease after prior RT, instillation of radioactive solution like phosphorus-32 or yttrium-90 may be considered. So these are all practiced in very select European centers, and personally, I have no experience with the same. I would again like to take you through a couple of articles which in my mind are important pertaining to radiation therapy in low-grade astrocytomas. So stereotactic radiotherapy for localized low-grade gliomas in children. Final results of a prospective trial from DFCI. A total of 81 patients were enrolled, all with small localized pediatric brain tumors, out of which 50 patients had low-grade glioma. The median age was 9 years. Indications of SRT were progression after chemotherapy or after surgery. And the PTV consisted of the preoperative tumor with a 2 millimeter margin. It is important to keep in mind that the study was conducted in the 1990s, and they used a cone-based SRT. The median collimator size was 4.725 cc with a range of 3 to 6 centimeter. And 3 to 9 arcs were used to deliver a mean total dose of 52.2 grays and 1.8 gray daily fractions. The median follow-up was just shy of 7 years, and in total, 6 patients had local progression, all within the primary tumor bed, and there was no marginal failure. And 2 out of 6 patients with local progression had a malignant transformation to anaplastic astrocytoma. 5 patients with tumors of the optic pathway or hypothalamus developed disseminated CNS metastasis. And 1 patient developed a presumed RP-induced PNET 6 months after initial treatment, and overall 6 patients died. So the PFS and OS at 8 years stood at 65% and 82%, which is pretty reasonable. And the authors concluded that SRT provides excellent local control for children with small localized low-grade glioma, and marginal failures have not been observed, supporting the use of small margins to minimize the late treatment-related side effects using stereotactic immobilization and planning technique. Second article I would like to take you through is clinical outcome and late endocrine neurocognitive and visual profiles of proton radiation for pediatric low-grade gliomas. 32 pediatric patients with low-grade gliomas of brain or spinal cord were treated with proton radiation from 1995 to 2007. I believe this is from Boston. 16 patients received at least 1 regimen of chemotherapy before RT. The median RT dose was 52.2 gray RBE. The median age of treatment was 11 years. The median follow-up time was 7.6 years. And the 8-year PFS and OS rates were excellent, 82.8% and 100% respectively. There was no significant decline in full-scale IQ. However, on subgroup analysis, they found that there was worse neurocognitive outcomes in smaller children less than 7 years, or with significant dose to the left temporal lobe or hippocampus. The incidence of endocrinopathy correlated with a mean dose of 40 gray RBE to the hypothalamus pituitary axis, and there was stabilization or improvement of visual acuity achieved in more than 80% of patients. And these are the Kaplan-Meier overall survival and progression-free survival curves in this cohort. And these are the images depicting proton beam radiation therapy for a hypothalamic glioma, for a pontine glioma, and a cervical cord glioma. we can appreciate that the higher isodose curves are very tightly huddled around the target volume and the low dose bath is quite minimal. Next, moving on to the molecular biology of pediatric low-grade glioma. So it is very important to comprehend the same. Is basically constitutive activation of the MAPK pathway, that is mitogen activated protein kinase pathway, where there is this axis, the RAS, RAF, MEK, ARC axis. And so whenever there is fusion of BRAF or mutation of BRAF V600E or CRAF fusion, this pathway becomes constitutively active. And this is inherently inhibited by NF1. So if there is mutation of the NF1, again, this pathway may be constitutively active, and this leads to subsequent activation of the mTOR pathway and disease proliferation and activation. So this is the depiction of the BRAF alterations as per location and histology. So this BRAF fusion, KIAA1549. So this is more commonly seen in pilocytic astrocytomas of the cerebellum, spinal cord, brainstem, and the optic pathway. On the contrary, BRAF V600E mutations are seen in a small minority of pilocytic astrocytomas in the cerebral cortex. They are more commonly seen in pleomorphic xanthoastrocytoma in the cerebral cortex and gangliogliomas in the temporal lobe. So these are the various targets which can be acted upon in patients with low-grade glioma. For BRAF V600 mutations, we have BRAF kinase inhibitor in the form of bemurafenib and dabrafenib. For the MEK, we have the MEK inhibitors like selumetinib and trametinib, and so on and so forth. So again, I'd like to take you through a couple of articles. So this was published in Neuro-Oncology in 2017. This is basically a phase one trial of the MEK inhibitor selumetinib in pediatric patients with recurrent refractory low-grade glioma. This is basically a pediatric brain tumor consortium study. So it included 36 eligible subjects with progressive low-grade gliomas. And the dose levels 1 and 2 were basically 33 and 43 milligram per meter square twice daily of selumetinib. These dose levels were found to be excessively toxic. So the most reasonable dose level was the dose level 0, which is basically 25 milligram per meter square per dose twice daily. And this was the recommended phase 2 dose. Only 3 out of 24 patients in this dose level experienced dose limiting toxicities, which were basically rash, mucositis, and elevation of amylase and lipase. In this dose level, the response rate was 20%, and majority of the patients had BRAF aberrations. The median cycles of selumetinib underwent were 13, and roughly 1/3 of the patients completed all protocol-defined treatment. So the 2-year PFS rate at the RP2D was around 70%. So the authors concluded that selumetinib has promising anti-tumor activity in children with low-grade glioma, with the most common toxicities of rash and mucositis. So this is a waterfall plot depicting very impressive decrease in tumor volume as seen on serial FLIR images and serial T1 post-CAT images with selumetinib. So quite logically, this was taken to the next level, that is a phase 2 trial. So this was published in Lancet Oncology in 2019. So these basically include
bedroom light after Shrap.
Okay, so this basically included patients with recurrent refractory or progressive low-grade gliomas with the age of 3 to 21 years and KPS of more than 60. And stratum 1 included patients with pilocytic astrocytoma harboring the BRAF aberrations. And stratum 3 basically included children with low-grade glioma associated with NF1. And selumetinib was administered at 25 milligram per meter square twice daily. And the response rate in strata 1 and 3 were 36% and 40% respectively. The most common toxicities were mostly mild grade 1 and grade 2. Grade 3 toxicities included elevated creatine phosphokinase, MACPAP rash, acneiform rash, paronychia, diarrhea, neutropenia, and nausea. Only one patient had grade 4 lymphopenia. So the authors concluded that selvagenib is active against recurrent refractory or progressive pilocytic astrocytomas harboring the BRAF aberrations or NF1-associated pediatric low-grade glioma. And this is the first prospectively tested and successful molecularly targeted agents in this patient group. So these are the Kaplan-Meier PFS curves in stratum 1 and stratum 3. And we can appreciate that the PFS is better in patients with BRAF fusion compared to those with BRAF V600E mutation. So these are the current experimental protocols for low-grade gliomas. Various phase 2 and even phase 3 randomized trials are ongoing. So they are kindly focusing on the use of oral vinorelbine, vinblastine versus vinblastine plus bevacizumab. Instead of 3 to 4 weekly carboplatin, they are exploring weekly carboplatin and vincristine. And they're also exploring the use of oral mTOR inhibitors like everolimus. Moving on to high-grade astrocytoma. So these account for 5% of all CNS tumors in the pediatric age group. And this is the most common tumor type in older adolescents. 2/3 of them are located in the cerebral hemisphere and the remainder equally divided amongst the posterior fossa and the deep midline structures. The duration of symptoms is usually short and the symptoms relate to the location of the lesion. So the common subtypes are the anaplastic astrocytoma, which is again a diffusely infiltrating malignant astrocytoma characterized by increased cellularity, nuclear atypia, and a significant proliferative activity. And this, the most common high-grade glioma, that is glioblastoma, is the most malignant astrocytic tumor. And the histologic features include cellular pleomorphism, nuclear atypia, microvascular proliferation, and pseudopalisading necrosis. In pediatric age group, it has been discovered that high-grade glioma mostly arises de novo without evidence of a less malignant precursor lesion in contradistinction to the adults. So this is again a slightly complicated slide depicting the molecular biology of pediatric high-grade gliomas. So what is notable is that there is often a recurring mutation involving the histone 3 protein. It might be histone 3K27M or histone 3.1K27M mutations. And these are more preponderant in midline tumors in the brainstem, that is midbrain and pons. The hemispheric tumors can again have recurring mutations of histone 3, but they are different, G34RV. There might be BRAF V600E mutations, IDH mutations, and the other category where there may be amplification of the EGFR overexpression of the platelet-derived growth factor receptor alpha and NMIG amplification. So it is notable that out of all these molecular subtypes, the best outcome is noted in patients with mutations of BRAF V600E. And these patients are usually adolescent patients. The survival is to the tune of 4 years, and the other molecular alterations resemble pleomorphic xanthoastrocytoma. Coming to surgery in pediatric high-grade glioma, it's a very important component of treatment, and most studies show a survival advantage for patients who have undergone complete resection. Maximal safe resection compatible with good neurologic outcome should be the goal for all patients. And second surgical procedure should be considered if there is a significant residuum after the first. Coming to radiation therapy, which is the most important component of treatment in pediatric high-grade glioma, postoperative RT is always indicated. Although leptomeningeal seeding is seen in a large minority, that is 10 to 30% of patients, the predominant pattern of failure in pediatric high-grade glioma is local, and the RT volume should be local. So the GTV is basically the tumor bed plus any residual enhancing or non-enhancing tumor plus any abnormality seen on T2-weighted MRI. The CTV consists of the GTV with an anatomically constrained expansion of 1.5 centimeter, and the PTV is the CTV with an isotropic expansion of 0.3 centimeter. Now, owing to large tumor size and the required dose often exceeding the tolerance levels for various critical organs at risk, for example, the chiasma opticum, a volume reduction may be considered at 50 to 54 gray. The dose to the PTV should be at least 54 gray given over 6 weeks, but the more standard dose is 59.4 to 60 gray. and this should be delivered if the same is feasible. And there is no current evidence that higher dose, that is dose escalation beyond 60 gray using stereotactic or brachytherapeutic boost or hyperfractionated RT results in improved outcome. SIB-IMRT delivering an accelerated treatment to a component of the target volume, such as the GTV, may be of interest, especially it decreases the overall treatment time and decreases the burden of treatment for the child and family. Moving on to chemotherapy in high-grade glioma, the role of chemotherapy needs to be further defined. Although responses have been seen to many agents and many regimens, mostly incorporating nitrosourease and temozolomide, the results are kind of difficult to interpret because in pediatric gliomas, the trials consist of small number of patients, and often the inclusion criteria with respect to pathology is inconsistent. That is, most of the trials have clubbed glioblastoma, gliosarcoma, and aplastic astrocytoma altogether. And the cooperative groups in North America and Europe are investigating a number of approaches that include novel chemotherapeutic and biotherapeutic agents, and participation in such clinical trials should be encouraged in those countries. Now, in our country, maybe extrapolating from adult trials and considering the poor prognosis, particularly after subtotal excision, the use of the current best regimen, that is concurrent and adjuvant temozolomide, may be argued for. So I would like to take you through a couple of studies which are important pertaining to chemotherapy in pediatric high-grade glioma. So temozolomide in the treatment of high-grade gliomas in children, a report from the COG, and this was published in Neuro-Oncology in 2011. 107 patients with glioblastoma, gliosarcoma, and aplastic astrocytoma were included in this study. 90 patients were deemed eligible for analysis. All patients underwent concomitant chemoradiotherapy. They were using a slightly different concurrent temozolomide dose, 90 mg per meter square once daily throughout the course of RT. And this was followed by adjuvant chemotherapy with temozolomide 200 mg per meter square once daily, day 1 to day 5, every 4 weeks for 10 cycles. MGMT expression was analyzed in 71 patients by IHC, not by methylation-specific PCR. And the three-year event-free survival and overall survival rates were quite dismal, 11% and 22% respectively. The two-year event-free survival was 17% in patients without MGMT overexpression compared to 5% in patients with MGMT overexpression, with the p-value being statistically significant. Now, when we split the clinical outcome, the three-year event-free survival in patients with anaplastic astrocytoma and glioblastoma, they were 13% and 7% respectively in the current trial compared to 22% and 15% in the preceding CCG945 trial. So there was no improvement in EFS with the addition of concomitant and adjuvant temozolomide. So this was one of the conclusions, and the other conclusion was MGMT overexpression adversely impacted event-free survival. Now we know that glioblastoma is often associated with neoangiogenesis, and glioblastomas under the microscope, they show microvascular proliferation, glioblastoma stem cells, they do have a vascular niche. So bevacizumab often has been tried with success in relapsed glioblastomas in adults, either alone or in combination with lomustine or irinotecan. However, when the adult groups tried to bring bevacizumab in the frontline setting, there was an increase, significant increase in PFS, but there was no tangible overall survival gain. So extrapolating from the adult studies, it was also investigated whether addition of bevacizumab to radiation and temozolomide in pediatric patients with newly diagnosed high-grade glioma really improves outcome. And this trial was conducted mostly in centers in Australia and Europe and was published in Journal of Clinical Oncology in 2018. So this was basically the randomized multicenter HERBI trial where 121 patients of pediatric 3 to 18 years non-brainstem glioma were randomized to RT plus temozolomide versus the same with additional bevacizumab. Temozolomide was given as per the Stupp regimen, only the adjuvant temozolomide was given for 12 cycles instead of 6 cycles. Bevacizumab was given again in standard dose of 10 mg per kilogram every 2 weeks, and the primary endpoint was event-free survival. So let us focus on the median event-free survival. It was 11.8 months in RT plus temozolomide versus 8.2 months in RT plus temozolomide plus Bev arm with a hazard ratio of 1.44. The p-value was, however, statistically non-significant. If you have a closer look at the Kaplan-Meier overall survival curves, which I have not brought, they were the median OS was pretty similar. However, there was a hazard ratio of death of 1.23 with the addition of bevacizumab. And grade 3-4 adverse events of special interest were 5% in RT plus temozolomide arm and 22% in the BEV arm, the most common adverse events being proteinuria and thromboembolic complications. So the authors concluded adding bevacizumab to RT plus temozolomide did not improve EFS in pediatric patients with newly diagnosed high-grade glioma. So nothing seems to be working pertaining to systemic therapy part in high-grade gliomas, and this is the current experimental protocols for high-grade glioma and DIPG. Basically, they are exploring the use of mTOR inhibitors, oral mTOR inhibitors like everolimus, CDK4/6 inhibitors, and also there is some experimental approach of transfection of oncolytic virus in the tumor, maybe oncolytic adenovirus or poliovirus. And it's also notable that to overcome the effect of histone 3 mutations, histone deacetylase inhibitors like vorinostat and panobinostat, they're also being tested in phase 1-2 trials in such patients. So the clinical outcome and prognostic factors in high-grade glioma, the prognosis for children with high-grade glioma is poor. The median time to progression is 10 to 11 months, and the 5-year overall survival is approximately 20%. The prognostic factors are age of the patient. There's better outcomes, surprisingly, if age is less than 3 years, because often these patients have been treated using baby protocols in various North American and European trials, which consists of intensive multi-agent chemotherapy with a view to deferring or avoiding radiation therapy. Extent of resection, better outcome with gross total resection. So this is no surprise. And tumor location, better outcome in hemispheric tumors because they're easier to resect. Pertaining to histology, anaplastic astrocytoma versus glioblastoma doesn't have any consistent difference in outcome in pediatric high-grade glioma in contrast to adults. Now moving on to the pediatric brainstem gliomas, they arise in the midbrain, pons, and medulla and account for 10 to 15% of all CNS tumors in the pediatric age group. They may be classified into favorable tumors, that is the low-grade focal tumors, the dorsal exophytic tumors, the cervicomedullary tumors, and the unfavorable tumors, that is the diffuse intrinsic pontine gliomas, DIPG. Coming to the low-grade focal tumors, they are usually well circumscribed, less than 2 centimeters. There's no evidence of infiltration or edema. They may be cystic. Often the cystic component may be more predominant compared to the solid component, and usually located in the midbrain and medulla. Usually present with a long-standing history of isolated cranial nerve deficit and contralateral hemiparesis, and signs and symptoms of raised intracranial tension are uncommon except in tumors arising in the tectal plate, which may cause aqueductal stenosis and hydrocephalus. So the management depends on the tumor location in the brainstem and specific imaging characteristics of the tumor. Patients with non-enhancing focal tumors in the tectal region when present with hydrocephalus do not require any additional treatment other than CSF diversion in the form of endoscopic third ventriculostomy. Active intervention, including biopsy, is reserved for patients with clinical and radiological evidence of disease progression. So these are some of the images of a patient with a very focal tectal glioma. It looks hypointense on T1-weighted MRI. Sagittal and axial sections, and hyperintense on T2 and flare. And this patient was subjected to biopsy, which showed a pilocytic astrocytoma, and then on progression, the patient was subjected to radiotherapy. And this patient was treated by proton beam radiotherapy, and we can see the isodose curves, the higher meaningful isodose curves, very closely compacted around the target volume with minimal low dose path, and almost perfect DVH curves for the target volume with in a sparing of various critical organs like hypothalamus, pituitary axis, and the chiasma opticum. So surgery is the treatment of choice for focal tumors at other locations that are surgically accessible. For example, the surface of the brainstem or the floor of the fourth ventricle. In experienced hands, the risk of morbidity for well-selected patients is very low. However, the outcomes are less satisfactory for patients with bulky tumors and for patients with tumors in the medulla, which often have lower cranial nerve deficits, and patients are at risk of developing post-operative feeding and breathing difficulties after surgery. For surgically inaccessible focal lesions, definitive RT 54 grays in 30 fractions over 6 weeks may be considered. The disease control rate with such approach is 50 to 70%. And other approaches like hyperfractionated RT with dose escalation, SRS, interstitial brachytherapy using iodine 125 seeds also have been used. So these are again the images of a patient with a focal glioma, low-grade glioma in the the pontomedullary junction. And this is on T1 and this is on T2 MR sequences. And this has been subjected to a biopsy. And this tumor was not accessible for surgery, so the patient was considered for radiation therapy. And on RT, there seems to be some increase in the size of the tumor with some edema and intralesional necrosis also. However, with the passage of time, these lesions kind of resolved, and we can see only focal encephalomalacia in the pontomedullary junction at MRI after 4 years. Coming to dorsal exophytic tumors, suffice to say that surgery is the mainstay of treatment. I will not be going in the details because in the interest of time. And I'll just show you some pictures. These are some of the images of a patient with dorsal exophytic glioma arising from the posterior aspect of the brainstem and filling the fourth ventricle. And this patient was subjected to surgery, and then there was progression of disease, and subsequently the patient underwent radiation therapy. And at the end of the treatment, there was near complete response. Cervicomedullary tumors, again, surgery is the mainstay of treatment. Now I will be focusing on the most common prototype of brainstem glioma, that is a diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma. It constitutes 70 to 80% of all brainstem tumors. It basically arises in the pons and causes diffuse enlargement and expansion of the same. There may be extension of the tumor to the midbrain and the medulla, and exophytic growth is seen in roughly 2/3 of the patients. Majority have fibrillary astrocytomas with a propensity for malignant transformation and a very poor prognosis. And they're usually hypo to isodense on CT scan with little post-contrast enhancement, and they're best seen on T2 or flare MR sequences. Ring enhancement usually suggests malignant transformation. The duration of symptoms is short, and usually it consists of a triad of multiple, often bilateral cranial nerve deficits, most commonly involving the sixth and the seventh cranial nerve, long tract signs leading to hemiplegia or hemiparesis, and ataxia because of extension of the tumor to the fibers of the middle cerebellar peduncle. Approximately 10% of the patients may have hydrocephalus at diagnosis. Surgery traditionally has got no role in the management of DIPGs. In the context of typical clinical presentation and very characteristic MRI findings, even biopsy, which is a relatively non-morbid procedure, is considered unnecessary outside a clinical trial. Though biopsy provides tissue, the study of which may unravel the molecular biology of DIPG, histology does not influence the treatment of DIPG as of now. Coming to the role of radiation therapy, treated with conventional RT, majority, more than 70% of patients improve clinically. The median PFS is, however, less than 6 months. The median OS is shy of 12 months, and the 2-year overall survival rate is less than 20%. The GTB consists of the gross tumor demonstrated on T2 or flare MR sequences. The CTV consists of the GTV with an anatomically constrained expansion of 1 to 1.5 centimeter, and the PTV comprises a CTV with an isotropic expansion of 0.3 centimeter. The most standard prescription dose is 54 grays in 30 daily fractions over 6 weeks, though some centers, they do use 60 grays in 30 fractions as well. And often RT needs to be started on a semi-urgent basis because of rapid progression of neurological deficit. There is steady improvement in clinical status as early as 2 to 3 weeks into RT. And this is often well appreciated by the family members, and steroids, if used, can be gradually tapered and discontinued at this point. Phase 1/2 studies of hyperfractionated RT with dose escalation from 64.8 to 78 gray has failed to show any improvement in time to progression and overall survival. Moreover, at higher doses of 75 to 78 gray, there's considerable morbidity in the form of steroid dependency, vascular events, white matter changes outside the RT portal, hearing loss, endocrinopathies, and late onset seizures in a small minority who happen to be long-term survivors. There have been single institute series of accelerated and hyperfractionated RTD genes, for example, 50.4 grays in 28 twice daily fractions, curtailing the treatment time to 3 weeks, or 39 grays in 13 daily fractions, or 45 grays in 15 daily fractions, with identical PFS and OS rates. However, there is potential benefit from reduced treatment duration, and this may help facilitate rehabilitation of patient, and more importantly, it decreases the burden of treatment for the child and the family. Even at our institute, there has been a small phase two randomized controlled trial comparing standard fractionation versus hyperfractionation, 39 grays, 13 fractions, with concomitant and adjuvant temozolomide in patients with brainstem glioma. This was performed in a different unit from mine, and this was published in Journal of Neuro-Oncology in 2019. And the hyperfractionated arm with concomitant and adjuvant temozolomide failed to show any kind of significant benefit compared to conventional fractionation alone. The role of chemotherapy, again, is kind of disappointing. None of the single-agent and multi-agent regimens in DIPG have conferred a significant overall survival advantage compared with RT alone. New agents biotherapeutics are under investigation by various pediatric cooperative groups in North America and Europe, and participation in clinical trials should be encouraged in those countries. So to summarize, pediatric glioma is a heterogeneous tumor entity. Some of the tumors may be very indolent and have a very long natural history, like the pilocytic astrocytoma. On the contrary, some tumors like glioblastomas may have, and GIPGs may have a very aggressive clinical course. And pediatric gliomas are very distinct from adult gliomas from the clinical and molecular biology perspectives. Maximal safe resection, preferably complete resection with preservation of neurological outcome, is advocated in both low-grade glioma as well as high-grade glioma. In low-grade glioma, after complete resection of tumor, no further treatment is necessary. Chemotherapy, usually consisting of a doublet of carboplatin and vincristine, should be considered in case of progression after surgery in infants and young children and all patients with NF1 with low-grade glioma. Radiation therapy, typically to a dose of 54 grays in 30 daily fractions, may be considered for symptomatic progression in older children with low-grade glioma, preferably by stereotactic radiotherapy or proton beam therapy if available. The MEK inhibitors, selumetinib, should be considered in recurrent refractory low-grade gliomas with PDAF aberration or association with NF1. And currently, there are a couple of COG trials where they are trying to test selumetinib in the first-line setting in low-grade gliomas. All pediatric patients with high-grade glioma, they merit post-op RT to a dose of 54 to 59.4 grays and 30 to 33 daily fractions. 59.4 to 60 gray is considered to be more standard. The role of chemotherapy needs to be further defined in pediatric high-grade glioma, and currently this two regimen, that is concurrent and adjuvant temozolomide, is most commonly used. Surgery is the mainstay of treatment for patients with focal, dorsal, exophytic, cervicomedullary brainstem gliomas. Definitive RT 54 grays in 30 daily fractions is the mainstay of treatment in patients with diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma. There is an ongoing effort amongst various pediatric cooperative groups across the Atlantic, in North America and Europe, to identify novel targets and develop smart drugs for incorporation in the existing treatment algorithms of pediatric glioma to optimize the clinical outcome, health-related quality of life, and simultaneously decrease the acute and, more importantly, the long-term toxicities of treatment. So with this, I would like to conclude, and I would be happy to take any questions.